Welcome to the interview. In the program today, we're going to be talking about a country in the Middle East which has the largest number of Christians today. Do you know which country it is? Well, we'll talk about it a bit more in a moment or two. But let me introduce to you two guests that I've got in the studio today to help us to understand the things that we want to talk about. The gentleman who's sitting opposite me is someone who, from my point of view, is very much an investigative journalist. We're used to having things like that in our Sunday newspapers, where they go and explore a situation and come back with all the right information. Well, this particular guest does exactly that, but in a Christian context. Andrew, lovely to have you with us today.
Thank you so much for coming and
meeting with us. And investigative journalist, is that a fair comment?
I think all journalists investigate. The idea is that you go and you see and you stand in the place of those that you wish to explain things to. So my job really is to be a bridge between an audience, people who want to know and who may need to know, and those that I get the privilege to travel with and meet, to convey their heart to the rest of us so that we can understand and stand in their shoes. That's the idea.
And you've been to a lot of countries. I mean, just reel off a few of the ones. We haven't got time for all of them, but so many.
Well, I think the worst place I've been to is Liberia, which was in civil war, but quite a lot in Africa. Sudan quite a few times. Burma, China, India, Pakistan.
Okay, so you see I've got an intelligent man with us today who's got a lot of things to share. Let me introduce to you my other guest, who I've only just met for a few moments earlier before the program, but I'm pleased to say that Paul Thomas is with us. Paul, thank you so much for coming and joining us. And Paul, your role, you work specifically with Release International at the moment, don't you?
Yeah, and the role I have at the moment is the campaign manager for our Egypt campaign, but I've been with Release for about 7 years now.
Okay, well, I'm looking forward to talking to you a little bit about that in a moment or two. And Paul has just given the game away. If you were trying to work out which country in the Middle East has the largest Christian population today, it is Egypt. Christian Coptic. I mean, Andrew, the very terminology Christian Coptic, many people be saying don't really know much about it. We're used to in this country having the Baptists and the Methodists and the Anglicans and Pentecostals and all the others. Christian Coptic, which is the predominant Christian body in Egypt.
Well, if you take the word Coptic and replace that with Egyptian, that's pretty much what it is. We're talking about Egyptian Christians who would have been there from the year dot. These are people who have come to faith centuries ago, the original church in the Middle East, part of that. So spreading out from Pentecost, you saw the movement of believers across the Middle East. And here the story runs that it was St. Mark who came to Egypt, who brought the faith to the Egyptian people. So it predates Islam by centuries. They are the original Egyptians. And their faith, to look at, it's orthodox. And if we're not familiar with what orthodox looks like, the closest parallel we'd have to that would be Catholic. I don't think they'd like me to say that actually much, because they are different. But we're talking about a faith which is really deep-rooted, which has a lot of contemplation within it. But for the Egyptians, for the Egyptian Orthodox, it's who they are. It's not what they believe. Their faith is absolutely everything about them. And one of the traditions they have is to tattoo, typically between the sort of web of the thumb and the forefinger, a Coptic cross. Sometimes it's on the wrist. And you see that all over the place. It's a sign of who you are, not just what you believe. So the typical Egyptian is probably, the typical Coptic Egyptian is possibly a nominal Christian, but there are many for whom their Coptic faith is a real vibrant and living faith, tied in very much with their national identity. So these are people who are Egyptians, and for them to be an Egyptian is to be a Coptic Christian.
And we saw the reality of their faith when some 20 of them were beheaded by ISIS in Libya. And yet even in that moment of death coming upon them, they were just giving thanks to God and praise to God.
Absolutely. And that was most spectacular own goal by Islamic State in all the propaganda that they produce. which is intended to terrify people. And it's appalling stuff to look at it. It's dreadful. But these guys, most of them Coptic Egyptians, one from Chad, the last words they said before they were beheaded, and think of that, were "My Lord Jesus," one after the other, "My Lord Jesus." So the faith for these people is deep rooted and real, and that extraordinary profession of faith, thanks to the Islamic State propaganda system, went across the world. Amazing.
And it's been followed on since, because I've certainly seen some, I think some television programs or the like, where people have been phoning in and you've been getting senior members of a Coptic church who are saying, listen, the thing we've got to do as believers is we've got to be peaceful, we need to be forgiving, we need to be reconciling, which is an enormous thing to do when an awful killing like that has just happened.
But you'd kind of expect that from senior church leaders. It's their job to do that. But not only them, but we'll see a little bit later in a video that we're going to look at, we're talking about members of their family whose brothers were killed, phoning in to television programs to say, we forgive those who killed. And that is a completely different spirit to the violent, murderous spirit that we're seeing out there, which is a faith of coercion, where people are being forced at knife point to convert and refusing, to a faith which says, whatever you do, we love you. Mm. Whatever you do, because Jesus loves us and continues to love us.
Amen. Well, Andrew, a couple of years ago, you went out to Egypt and recorded some footage of what was happening there at the time. And it was pretty horrendous in terms of a Christian attack, of the attack that was happening among Christians at the time. Let's just remind ourselves of some of the churches that were attacked that you filmed at that time.
They've been described as unprecedented, the worst attacks against Christians in Egypt since the 14th century. After the removal of Muslim Brotherhood President Morsi, militants launched revenge attacks on more than 80 churches, businesses and homes, and killed members of a wedding party. Egypt's believers are the largest remaining Christian community in the Middle East and one of the oldest, but their numbers are falling. Upwards of 100,000 have left since the revolution. And when President Morsi was overthrown, Christians were attacked across the country, especially in Upper Egypt.
The Brotherhood were attacking the police station of Beni Mazar, where we live. There was shooting between them and the cops. They jumped over the side of the church and burned the church. Everybody was screaming, and even the trees of the church were burning. They burned down the main auditorium, everything, all of our electrical installations, the sound systems, all the benches that we sat on, all the decorations and paintings of the church were burned out. One group attacked the house. They took money from my apartment. They also attacked the canteen and the computer room of the church and the Sunday school. They burned that down.
Well, that was some footage of Egypt a couple of years ago. I think the problem, Andrew, when we think of Egypt, is we think of it as one country, or we just think of the tourist resort spots that maybe some people have been to. But in fact, Egypt is a huge, sprawling country, isn't it? And what happens in the big cities is sometimes very different to what happens in some of the rural areas.
Yes, and when you think about the revolution in Egypt and the counter-revolution there, most of us will be familiar with the name Tahrir Square, for example. Well, it's not a square, it's like a huge roundabout in the middle of Egypt where all the demonstrations took place, the helicopters flying over from the army, dropping flags, and then throwing out President Morsi, who had himself been swept to power less than a year before that. Extraordinary turmoil. But Cairo, which is a smoggy, crowded, bustling, in-your-face city, is a world apart from what's known as Upper Egypt, which is south of there. It's to do with where the Nile is located. You go 3 hours across the desert, very, very hot. You wouldn't want to break down. And you follow the Nile, and the Nile is the source of all life for Egypt. Everything that is fertile springs from the Nile. But you get to Upper Egypt, on the Nile again, to a place called Minya, and suddenly it's very, very different. You're talking about towns which look recognisable as towns, but soon move into a villagey kind of sprawl. Narrow little streets, houses that are overlooking one another, very crowded, and a world apart from Cairo. The difference between the urban big city there and the rural sprawl is really quite marked. And that's where most of the attacks took place against Christians. That's the place where there is an army presence, but you'd have to look for it. In Cairo, it's everywhere. The military's everywhere in Cairo. But in places like these, the Christians are very, very vulnerable. And that's where, in protest at the overthrowing of the Muslim Brotherhood, that's where the attacks began against Christians.
So you talked about President Morsi being put out and the overthrow of the Brotherhood. But has it really gone, or is it just underground?
It's been sat on very, very hard. So, and there's a lot of injustice in Egypt. So many, many Brotherhood supporters were killed. A lot of them have been imprisoned. Some of them have been executed. And it's something which has been squished right down. Now, that kind of thing has been in Egypt for decades. It isn't going to go away. And there is, of course, the harder you repress a group of people, yes, you restore order, but you create a fresh sense of grievance. And there's no question that there is still a simmering sense of grievance underground in Egypt. That's not to criticize President al-Sisi, who's taken power. He's got an incredibly difficult job to do. But the harder you squeeze, the more trouble you store up for yourself.
Okay. Well, we saw pictures there of attacks upon churches. But attacks haven't only been upon churches. They've also been upon individuals too. And so if you're known as a Christian, then there's a very real danger of your life being threatened. And I think that what we're going to see now is not only material that is affected, but also lives as well. Let's have a look.
The mobs also targeted Christian homes and businesses, sending out scouts to mark which ones to attack. These boats belonged to Christians.
It was an amazing thing for us when we come to Umayya. We used to gather here, worship, do meetings, have lunch with teams. Like, even they come outside Egypt, we have them here and invite them to lunch and meals and spend good times over here. It was well known that it's a Christian boat. It was actually the seminary for many years. This boat is 150 years old, and it used to travel through the states or the governorates of Egypt to be like a movable seminary, and the people would study and have intensive classes on the deck of this boat from different states all over Egypt. As you see, this ship behind me is the Mermaid, is the other ship that was burned down. And what happened for the two people were killed, these two people, when they heard about the Brotherhood are coming, they, from fear, they hidden in the, inside the restroom, both of them together.
Well, that was footage that was shot 2 years ago in Egypt. Now the Brotherhood have gone. President Morsi is no more. We now have President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi in charge. He's a much more strong man, and he's gone on record as saying that Christians should be able to be alongside Muslims. So what did you find when you went back?
He has the world's most difficult job on his hands. You say the Brotherhood have gone. Well, they haven't gone. Politically, they no longer exist, but they're still there. So, and everything they represent is still there. And essentially what they want is a very Islamic Egypt. And it was the movement towards turning Egypt into a very upfront Islamic state that nearly brought the country to ruin, which is why less than a year in power, the people of the nation rose up and said, enough. Now, the difficulty for Christians there, who are in a very small minority in Egypt, is that they were seen to be a voice who was saying, we want the Brotherhood out. Now, you need to recognize that that millions went out on the streets, millions went out to protest. So many more people wanted him out than just the Christian minority, but the Brotherhood took it out on the Christians there. So when the army general, took power in what was criticized in the West as being a military coup, and from our perspective it might well have been like that. He then ran for president and was elected in by a landslide. And what then happened was that the constitution was changed, and I know we'll have a look at that in a moment in the longer film that we're going to do. But what he's got to do is, you've got Islamic State on the edges of Egypt. So in the desert, pressing in, you've got Islamic State militants there. You've got the Brotherhood, repressed and still underground. You've got a culture within Egypt of discrimination, because Christians have always been discriminated against in Egypt. They don't tend to talk about persecution. They're an extraordinary people, actually. They talk about the pressure. Mm-hmm. They'd rather not talk about persecution. It forced the people like us to talk about it on their behalf. But they've been discriminated against in the workplace. They've been regarded very much as second-class citizens. All the garbage collectors in Egypt are Christians. Some of them are there because they've fled persecution in order to be there. So you've got a culture which, regardless of what the constitution now says, which is equality, and thank God for that, it's important, it's a start, but you've got a culture of discrimination against Christians. Cairo is urban, it's bustling, it's progressive, but you get out into those areas that we just saw, where those two boats were burned, people burnt to death inside those, and you've got a very, very different culture. You also have a different culture in Egypt's courts, because many of the judges have been there a long time, and what they also want is an Islamic Egypt. So the discrimination, which may be changing within the law, has not yet changed within the culture. So the general has said to the Coptic Christians, he said, we are Egyptians. All of us are Egyptians. That was a big message to the Islamists within Egypt. He's also gone and spoken at Al-Azhar Mosque, which is the center of Islamic learning in the Middle East. And he said, look, the violence has got to stop. So what he's doing in order to create stability in his country is clamping down very hard on anything that is seen to be rocking the boat. And that sadly still includes quite a number of Christians.
But there's a lot of progress over 2 years, so you must feel encouraged looking back over a two-year period. I mean, I saw one report which said that President al-Sisi was the first ever Egyptian president to attend a Christian mass, and standing side shoulder to shoulder with the Coptic leader, this Muslim president declared, we are Egyptians. So that's a first for Egypt. That surely is exciting, and from a Christian point of view, must be very positive for the Christian.
Absolutely. I wouldn't knock it for a moment, and nor would I want his job for a moment,
yeah.
Because there's so much that he needs to do. There's a lot he's done. There's so much he needs to do. But from an outsider's point of view, when you look at the way Egypt is being governed now, and you look at it under dictatorship of Mubarak, you begin to wonder what actually is the difference. Now, there are very, very positive signs, but there's a great deal of repression.
Okay, well, let's at this point bring in Paul Thomas. And Paul Thomas is the campaign director, is that right? Or manager?
Yeah.
Manager,
yeah.
Don't elevate you too much,
nope,
shall
no.
we? With Release International. Mm-hmm. So, Paul, you've got the job, therefore, of, well, I don't know, what is your job? Tell us.
With this campaign,
yes.
Specifically, it's to raise the awareness of the issue which Andrew has described, which is the fact that we have a constitution in Egypt which is welcome. They made changes in January 2014, which provide in the constitution freedom of religion, and that's for all the Abrahamic faiths, for Islam, for Judaism, and for Christianity.
And that must be an enormous thing for a country which is considered to be an Islamic state.
It's a very positive step forward to do that, and to place that within the constitution is a fantastic step forward. The problem we were hearing about, and the reason we took this campaign forward this year, is that having a constitution is one thing, and that's excellent, but actually it wasn't being worked out in practice. One human rights monitor has described it as putting a beautiful frame around an ugly picture. The picture is still ugly. And so we have a constitution which should provide freedom of religion for all these faiths, but we have a penal system which is too often used to bring in blasphemy charges against people where they shouldn't be brought. So constitutionally, it should be illegal for these people to be charged with anything, but other areas of the penal code are often used then to bring charges against people, which are false charges.
Okay, I mean, we're used to countries like Pakistan, sadly, mm-hmm. where penal charges and charges of blasphemy or desecrating the Quran become known. But Egypt?
Well, think of Pakistan and 52C, the blasphemy law in Pakistan, and they have 93F in the penal code in Egypt, which is used in a similar way.
Say that again. You were too fast for me.
They're two. In Pakistan, we have 52C, which is their blasphemy law, which released campaign about several years ago, about the repeal of that. In Egypt, you've got penal code 93F, which is equivalent.
That's what's in their constitution.
It's in their penal code, not the constitution, but it allows blasphemy charges to be brought by the judges who, as Andrew has already said, are still very pro an Islamic state in Egypt. So whatever the constitution is saying, many of the judiciary would still like to see Islamic law across Egypt.
Okay, and we may see a little later in the footage a gentleman called Bishoy Boulos, and he's one such person who was a Muslim, became a Christian, and is struggling now because of the very thing that you're talking about.
He's a Muslim. He became a Christian. He became a Christian in 1998. His wife also changed her religion to Christianity in 2007. He sought to have his ID card. He was the first to challenge the system which has your religion on your ID card and sought to have it changed from Muslim to Christian. He remains in jail today under blasphemy charges, and certainly this year we've been reporting on his case highly as part of the campaign, because he's been beaten in prison. He's remaining in prison under charges which he shouldn't really be in prison under this, as I say, this blasphemy law. Along with many others who were pardoned last week, we believe he should have been on that list of people who were pardoned because they're unjustly imprisoned at this time in Egypt.
I mean, we don't tend to think of Christians being in prison today in Egypt simply because of their faith. Mm. So is he the exception to the rule, or are
there? No, there are others, and we reported last month on another man who was giving out Bibles or Christian literature in a shopping mall in Cairo, and he was reported by a member of the public. He was arrested, and again, they've used, while it's legal for him, there's nothing in the constitution which stops him from doing that. 93F and the penal code has been used against him to actually bring charges of blasphemy and insult in Islam, and so he's finding himself on these charges at the moment.
Okay. Well, I suppose the question then is, what can we do? I mean, the very fact that the two of you are here today and we're talking about Egypt is highlighting it, and I'm sure viewers are listening and taking note of what's being said. But as a campaign manager, you're wanting to do more than simply just talk about it. So what is Release doing? What are you doing? What can we do?
Okay, we'd encourage people to look at our petition, which is still available online through our website, releaseinternational.org, and to sign a petition which we will be taking to the Egyptian ambassador to try and discuss these issues with him, to discuss the discrepancy between the constitutional freedoms and these elements of the penal code which are being used against Christians still, but also to discuss the issues that Andrew has described with the difference in security in Cairo compared to the security available to Christians in Upper Egypt, where when we were there, we met with Christians who'd been attacked, who'd been displaced from their homes. We were in a church which 2 years ago had been set on fire. It's been restored now, but they still live in a Muslim-majority village amongst the same neighbors who set fire to their church, with the possibility that it could happen again at any time, given the level of security available to them. So we are hoping to discuss with the Egyptian ambassador in London at the end of this campaign these issues, and just encourage the Egyptian government to take these issues forward and look at where these discrepancies are still occurring. Apart from that, we'd encourage, as part of any campaign we'd run, we hope that, you know, as Christian believers, the first thing we're going to do is pray. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, pray for not the success of this campaign, but for the outcome for the people we're campaigning on behalf of. because these are the people we take on these campaigns. We've taken on this campaign because it's our brothers and sisters in Egypt who are suffering as a result of these discrepancies. And so we need to hold them in our prayers at all times, as well as sign our petition, we hope, and add your voice to the number of voices we'll take forward when we meet with the ambassador.
Okay, and just remind us, it's
www.releaseinternational.org.
And Andrew, when we were talking before the program about what to put under your name, we put filmmaker. And that's what you dedicated yourself to over many, many years. And you've made a film about Egypt, haven't you?
Yes, that's right. The point of it, Gordon, really, is if we're going to pray, as Paul rightly says we should pray, you have to know who you're praying for.
Yeah.
Now, I realized a long time ago as a journalist, my background was not film, it was radio and print. But I realized the power of video to look at people, to see their eyes. You might not understand the words coming out of their mouths, you're dependent on the subtitles, but you get their heart. They put their heart across. Now, if by some accident of birth we were living in Egypt right now, we were Egyptians, we would be struggling in exactly the same way. And Hebrews 13 tells us, remember your brothers and sisters as though you yourself were suffering. So for me, it's a sense that when Jesus was in Gethsemane, he said to his disciples, will you just watch and pray with me because I am struggling right now. They couldn't do it. They couldn't do it. When we go and be with our brothers and sisters in Christ, you and me in a different place, we stand with them, we put our arms around their shoulders, we let them tell their stories. I believe that we're watching and we're praying. And when we do it for them, we do it for Jesus. And that means it's far more possible to pray. Do you know, this summer I was at Faith Camp, which is my church runs a camp in Peterborough. And somebody who came to the camp on the unit that I was hosting said to me, I saw your program on Revelation TV about Iraq, and I haven't stopped praying for the couple that I saw ever since. I think, fantastic, that's exactly what we want, because it's created that heart connection. So I'll just invite viewers now to listen to these stories, watch these stories, and let these people get into your heart, because God will use you to pray.
Mm. So we're going to show the whole film, including the financial appeal at the end and all the credits going up. And we're doing that because this is available for people, isn't it? I think they can make a donation to release and they can get copies of the film, is that right?
They can phone our office, they can get a copy of the film. We invite a donation, but we'd be happy to send it out.
Okay. And so if exactly what you said, if people want to pray, then they could show this at a house group, they could show it in their church, they could show it wherever, and it's a means of getting the message out.
That's right, and there's a short version of it as well for showing in church.
Okay. All right. So let's have a look at the film. It's called Glimmers of Hope, and it's a real view of what the church in Egypt is experiencing at this moment of time.
Revolution and counter-revolution. After just a year in power, the Muslim Brotherhood is ousted in a military coup. Protesters are shot. Rioters take their revenge on Egypt's Christian minority, burning scores of churches, homes and businesses. Then military strongman Abdel Fattah al-Sisi is swept to power. Having banned the Brotherhood, the general becomes the president, with 97% of the vote. He's the first Egyptian president ever to attend Christmas Mass. Standing shoulder to shoulder with the Coptic Pope, this Muslim president declares, "We are Egyptians." At the seat of Islamic learning, Al-Azhar University, al-Sisi calls for Islam to break free from extremism. The world, he says, is waiting for your answer. The church burning stops. He gives the order to rebuild them. Then he changes the constitution to guarantee freedom of belief. But that will be easier said than done. Egypt's Christians have long been treated as second-class citizens. They've faced discrimination in education and employment. And that simmering persecution against them they call the pressure erupted into violence in 2013. So could change finally be in store for Egypt's Christians? Anzaki is a professor at Cairo's Evangelical Theological Seminary.
The fact that we have a constitution that articulates the rights of Christians and minorities is already a great sign of hope for us. So when we see the government being more willing in giving licenses for new church buildings, when we see the doors of the president's office open to clergy, to the Christian Pope, we see signs of a government that's willing to recognize us as full citizens of this nation. Not only do the Christians have the right and the freedom to worship, but they will be backed up by the military, and they will be backed up by the government, and they will be protected. This government is moving in the right direction towards religious freedom, towards the equality of the equality in treating the Christian community in Egypt. And that gives me great signs of hope.
Advocates of progress point to the recent jail sentences for 69 rioters who set fire to this church in Kadassa, Cairo. Here it is today, still a place of worship and still unrepaired. But many of those rioters were tried in their absence and melted away. Others who've attacked Christians plead insanity and are never brought to justice. However, Christians are still being jailed for blasphemy along with atheists. Christian convert Bishoy Boulos is still better known by his former Muslim name, Mohammed Hegazi. In Egypt, the rite of conversion is a one-way street. Christians can become Muslims, but when Mohammed became a Christian and tried to change his religion on his identity card, he was jailed, received death threats, and had his home set on fire.
We have suffered a lot because our ID states that we are Muslim and we are living as Christians. So I decided to have that fight, to ask for my rights to change my religion on the ID.
Bishoy was jailed for reporting the persecution of Christians and has now been accused of blasphemy. According to reports, he's beaten regularly in jail. So what price freedom of belief? It appears the government is cracking down on anything that looks like dissent. Troublemaking in any shape or form will not be tolerated. And that trouble has been felt most acutely by Christians in Minya, a searing desert drive from Cairo and away from international attention. Pastor Marus Church in Sanyem village was one of scores targeted by protesters, along with police stations, courts, and other symbols of authority. Among the attackers were their neighbours, who set the church on fire and then tried to lure the family of four into the flames. We got up and we were very frightened, says Pastor Marus, and I looked from the window and I saw them coming towards the church door. They were throwing Molotov bombs towards the walls of the church. And I asked them, "Why are you doing this? We're brothers and we're living together and we love you." They said, "We are not brothers." Pastor Marus, his wife Nadia, and their two young children have had trauma counseling. "God gave us forgiveness for those people," he says, "and he raised us up again to do his work." Although the army is gradually restoring Egypt's damaged churches, the 80 Christian families of this Assemblies of God congregation just couldn't wait. Despite their poverty, they pooled what little they had to pay for their church to be restored. "We became like one man and worked," says Pastor Marus, "and God was with us and gave us success. It felt like a reward, a heavenly reward." Today, he says, the congregation is growing and is stronger than before. 300 attend each Sunday. The church even runs a food bank and supports its Muslim neighbors. The women's prayer meeting is led by Mariam. After the attack, she says, "We couldn't walk the streets. We were so afraid that we were crying. But we had faith in God that He would take care of us. Right now, we can see the hand of God controlling everything. We're so happy." Release is encouraging Egypt to give full equal rights to Christians, not just in theory, but in practice, and not just in Cairo. And it's the Christians in the small towns beyond Cairo who still face the greatest pressure, who suffer the greatest persecution, and it could take more than a change in the constitution to turn things around. The whole culture will have to change. Paul is a carpenter. We're concealing his face to protect him. He says he was hounded out of his village along with his family for trying to convert a building into a church. He says the police threatened to shoot me. They put me in a cell with Muslim extremists so they could get rid of me. Paul told the militants, "I am coming to you like a sacrifice." And then, he says, the miracle happened. "We're not killers," they told him. And they fed him and took care of him. "I was like Daniel among the lions," says Paul. "I thank God." But his family suffered too. Paul says the authorities tortured his father with electricity until he lost his hearing. His daughter was beaten up at her primary school and made to fail her exams. He says, "I received many threatening phone calls saying, 'Take care of your kids.'" Paul knew three of the Coptic Christians murdered by Islamic State in Libya just for being Christians. Their last words before they were beheaded were to cry out, "My Lord Jesus."
Jesus.
Like his friends, Paul says, "Jesus is my life. He brought me from darkness into light." One measure of the brightness of that light is the depth of the forgiveness. Family members of the beheaded Coptic Christians called into a television program to forgive their killers. That program was screened by SAT7, a partner of Release International. Fouad Youssef is on the board of directors. He says the church can never fail.
Burning churches will never affect the church. It empower the church. Killing believers, it will empower the believers. And facing problems never stop this big body from growing.
Meanwhile, in Minya, in his lovingly restored church, Pastor Marous looks to the future through the eyes of faith. "Our hope for Egypt is that God would open the eyes of the people to Christ," he says. It seems to be happening. At this prayer meeting in Cairo, televised live, Egyptian Christians pray for their country and for the grace to love even those who kill them. The story is told of an ordinary Egyptian who came into the meeting hungry for God and met God in this church. Many ordinary Muslims say they're sick of extremist violence. Some are declaring themselves atheists and are being jailed for it. Others are finding Jesus, says Mario Basilios, a worker at Casa El Dabara Church.
What God's doing is like he's doing a huge revival among the youth and the people now. Like he's shaking the old beliefs, and like so many other, like people who are in different religion and atheists are seeing the truth, meeting God in vision, insisting to follow Jesus through persecution and stuff.
Very good.
Pastor Marous and his family have gone through persecution and come out the other side stronger. He says, pray for God to use us here to extend his kingdom. Pray for an end to terrorism in Egypt. Pray for our church to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Please also put your compassion into action by making a gift to support persecuted Christians around the world. Please visit the Release International website, email, or phone. Thank you.
And if you'd like a copy of that film or a shortened version of it, then please do contact Release International. And from time to time across the screen, we're putting the details of how you can do that and their website. And Paul, that you want to make copies available, is that right?
We certainly want to get people to be aware of what is happening to our Christian family in Egypt, to be praying for them, but also, as I say, as part of this campaign, to take action on their behalf so that we can add people's voices when we speak to the ambassador and just raise these issues with him.
Yes. Amen. Well, Andrew, I want to say thank you to you for making the film for us and just making it available to the wider sense. We appreciate that very much indeed.
I really appreciate Revelation Television and yourself for backing this. Much appreciated, Gordon.
Okay, well, I look at a film like that and I'm very encouraged because I think there are so many positives in there in terms of the attacks by and large have stopped upon churches. Although there's still some terrible things that are happening, you record things like licenses are now being granted for new churches to be built, that the government even are providing some funds for those that have been damaged. We saw the president actually went to a Christian event, which was the first time. Are you encouraged having gone back 2 years later?
Yes, the film is called Glimmers of Hope because that's what it is. And you know, a parallel comes to mind. If you think about the fall of the Soviet Union, when Gorbachev came to power, announcing perestroika, which was a change of direction, there was turmoil for years after that. In fact, there's still turmoil today in the former Soviet Union. But he set a course and he set a direction. Now, that direction has been set in Egypt. The constitution has changed. The president has made a number of things absolutely clear. But he needs to take an entire culture behind him. And that is going to take time to do, but it also needs scrutiny. You know, we're used in democracies to having a free press, which says, actually, you're not living up to your promises, you need to. What's happening in Egypt is that journalists who are talking about the trouble are ending up behind bars. You mentioned Bishoy Boulos. Mm-hmm. Now, he reported some of what was happening, and that was considered to be one step down from espionage. Those kind of things have got to change, and it will take time, but it's so important not just to stand back and say, excellent start, but to say, excellent start, please keep going. We're watching, we're concerned, we're praying for your country, and we're praying for you. So it's about getting behind and getting that momentum and keeping that momentum moving.
Okay, sounded like a school report for one moment, I thought there, Andrew, where you were saying, well, doing okay, but could do better. And I suppose that's it, really. And ultimately, it's prayer, isn't it, as the Christians and the believers. I mean, we talk about it, but as we pray, but miracles have happened in the last 2 years. Miracles have been happening over the last two centuries, but particularly in the last 2 years, there's been a huge change around in Egypt. And we need to pray that what has started will continue.
Yes, absolutely so. And the greatest miracle, I think, that we've seen over there is a miracle in people's hearts, the hearts of people like Pastor Marous. Do you know, 100,000 plus, nobody knows the number of people have left Egypt. But I do know that many of the brightest and the best Christian leaders have left that country. That's not to criticize them. The scriptures give you two positions to take. When they come for you, run. And on the other hand, keep your faith and stand firm. So we just have to be led by God and know what to do. But for Pastor Marous to stay there with his family, having endured an attempt to kill them by fire, and then to set up a food bank to feed the Christian neighbors, the ones who tried to drag them into the flames, to see a fresh favor coming on their church, a fresh favor coming on their ministry, that really is the overcoming faith that the Bible talks about. Two huge things to overcome. One is hatred, and that means forgiveness. And the other is fear, and that means faith. These people are an inspiration to us all.
Because we began, didn't we, by talking about where was the largest Christian community in the Middle East, and we said it was Egypt. But, I mean, there were Christian communities in many other parts of the Middle East. And sadly, because of the persecution and because Christians have had no alternative but to run, the Christian communities in many other parts of the Middle East has diminished now to a very small minority.
Absolutely so. Many commentators are saying that there is a real risk that the church the birthplace of the church, the Middle East, could be absolutely empty of Christians unless this is turned around. So the situation with Islamic State, huge drift out of Christians from Iraq and other nations. Lebanon has a growing Christian population. Those are refugees. Kurdistan in the north of Iraq has a growing Christian population. But those are refugees who don't actually want to stay there. They want to leave and get out. Mm-hmm. So we're seeing an almost inexorable exodus of Christians from the birthplace of the faith. Mm-hmm. And that is a tragedy. The good news is that, as Jesus said in Matthew 24, when you see these things happening, don't be alarmed, he said. He'd have to have said that with a smile on his face. Because these are just the birth pains. Now, we look at what's happening in the Middle East, and it looks like death throes, but actually we're seeing birth pains of what? It says in Hebrews 2:10 that God is bringing many sons to glory. Mm-hmm. And we've seen in Egypt that many ordinary Egyptians who are looking at what is being carried out in the name of their faith are saying, this cannot be right. The God I worship cannot be doing this. Where are you? They're looking for God. Some of them are going into the churches, and some of them are finding him. Mm-hmm. And God is giving ordinary Egyptians dreams and visions, and that's happening across the Middle East. There is a remarkable move of God happening. And many, of course, are coming here looking for refuge, and it's an opportunity for the church in this country to bring comfort, love. God talks about cords of human kindness, and to share their faith with people that God is bringing to us.
And that's why we wanted to do a program today on Egypt, because it's on God's heart and it needs to be on our heart too. And I know that you pray for many different things and are involved in many different things, but I want to encourage you to put Egypt on your prayer list too, and begin to pray and begin to campaign. And every time there's something on the news or in the newspaper that talks about Egypt, say, Lord, I'm praying for that country, for individuals to come to know the Saviour, and for the church there to be protected and built up and matured in the faith. Paul, campaign manager for Egypt, do you feel what you're doing is, I don't know how you measure success, but do you think that your campaign is proving worthwhile and encouraging?
In terms of engaging people with the issue, making people aware of the issue, most certainly. And we pray that when we do get the opportunity to speak to the ambassador, that we'll be well received. And we've certainly have experience with other campaigns of this being the case. So certainly with the Pakistan campaign we ran several years ago, which I was involved with, we were very warmly received by a high commissioner in that case for Pakistan, who had a similar agenda as a secular politician, a Muslim man, but a secular politician, who himself had seen a good friend of his just assassinated the month before, Salman Taseer, the governor of Punjab. What we were campaigning for, the abolition of the blasphemy law, aligned itself with his thinking as well. So we were very warmly received. So we pray that we'll be equally warmly received by the ambassador in London when we present these issues and discuss these issues, hopefully in a very calm framework. We've already described the positive things that have been taking place in the last 2 years, certainly in Egypt, and we want to commend the Egyptian government for this, but just say you need to take this now and work it out further in practice, so that what you are saying you want to achieve for your nation, that all faiths or people of all faiths are Egyptian, not just those of the Islamic faith, that let's work that out in practice, and we are supporting, we are praying for them as they seek to do that.
That's right, because one of the hardest things is to raise the profile, which is what you're doing. Our news is dominated every day by the latest thing that is happening, and particularly some of the other countries like Syria and elsewhere, really get the highlights of what's happening. And many, many people, I suspect, even today, don't really know what the situation is like in Egypt.
No, and that is the reason we highlight not just Egypt, but the other countries we're involved with, because countries come and countries go in terms of newsworthiness, and clearly at the moment the news is all about Syria and the not only what's happening to the people of Syria, but the international response, what's happening there. So Egypt is very much not on the world's minds at the moment. So yeah, it's our job to make sure that, because there are families still in Egypt, so it's our job to make sure that their family here in the UK and Ireland is aware of what is still happening. It's persistent. It needs our prayers, and we need to continue remembering them, as Andrea said, from Hebrews 13 through. That's our constant scripture mandate, to remember those who are suffering as though we suffered with them, and those who are in prison as though we are in prison with them. So when we think of Bishai Bulas, we need to remember him as if we are there with him. We need to feel his pain because he's part of the same body as we are. So it's important that we keep these things in our supporters' minds, in the minds of the church in the UK.
Thank you. And thank you for what you're doing. Andrew, you talked just a moment ago about dreams and visions and miracles of God. And there was one particular church that you, back in 2013, filmed, which really had a miracle in terms of the escape for the people and in terms of keeping a mob at bay. Let's just remind ourselves about how God, in the most amazing way, can bring miracles about.
Later that day, a 1,000-strong mob were heading for Bishop Thomas's Cathedral in Assyut.
When you hear that more than 1,000 person coming, with some of them having machine guns, some of them they would have petrol bombs, and some of them they were having other weapons, and you just see that, and you hear that other churches was burned on the way. What are you going to do? And it's a big challenge here. Then we gathered the people and we went to the church and we prayed. And after just a short prayer, we came up with the idea. And the idea was the alley that is leading to the church. It was a small alley. And then we asked the people to throw water, lots of water, in the street, so it becomes very wet. And we poured as well a liquid soap. So it became very slippery, actually, because lots of water was liquid soap. It made it like really cannot stand in it. The people, these big demonstrations, were coming in, and as soon as they enter into the alley of the church, because it was slippery, so they start to fall and stumble one after the other, and they were really shocked that there is some preparation was prepared for this kind of attack. They returned back and then they came back again and it happened the same thing, but they couldn't come into the church, and they start to burn the houses outside, and they were attacking some of the shops and the pharmacies and the things that belong to the Christians there. The message that I wanted to tell for everyone: no fear, do not be afraid. This is a must. And do not hate. This is a very important thing. Christians, we have to face challenges with strong faith and with love, working for reconciliation, because this is our message, is peace building.
Well, we tend to think of God doing the miraculous in the most amazing ways, but who'd have thought soap and water? That's an amazing story, Andrew.
It's wonderful, isn't it? You know, we nearly missed that we got the interview with Bishop Thomas on our way back to the airport from that trip in Egypt. And it was just such a joy. You see, you asked earlier, what is a Coptic Christian? Now, there's a great example of a Coptic Christian, a man who's actually radiant with faith. It may be rather different to my own. It's the same Lord. The expression of it might be different, but a man who's radiant with faith and who can say, having gone through all of that, the guns, the Molotov cocktails, all heading his way, he says, we got together and we had an idea. Astonishing. What an amazing Old Testament style deliverance that was.
Yes.
Nobody hurt apart from falling over on a bit of soapy water.
No. I mean, we tend to expect that God's going to work in a most dramatic way. And yet sometimes it's the most simplest, but he just drops the idea into us. Well, we're in the last couple of minutes of the program. Both of you have spent time in Egypt. You've met the people. You've talked with them. If I just said, you know, just tell us briefly about one person or one situation that really blessed you and touched you. Anything come to mind that you particularly would want to share?
We saw on one of the videos the lady in Pastor Maurice's church, who I interviewed while we were there. She was leading a group of Christian women. And it was great to see that church restored, great to see the joy in their faces. But then the very next morning, we met another lady whose husband had been shot. Andrew, we referred to the cross on the wrist. He was shot first through his wrist, then he was killed. And she'd been displaced. And it just reminded me the fragility of life, the fragility of the situation of these people out there. So we need to keep them on our hearts, because as much as we're seeing progress, life outside Cairo is very fragile for our brothers and sisters, so we need to keep them in our hearts at this time.
Andrew?
And I think for me it's the carpenter whose face we couldn't show you, because his face was radiant. He pointed to the cross that he was making, or the decoration that he was making with the flower, and he said, Jesus. And he said in English, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. He's a man who lost everything, whose family had been under threat, who's been displaced. Radiant faith.
Amen. Well, radiant faith, that's what we've been talking about, and I pray that your faith is radiant and that you'll keep coming before the Lord and praying for the country of Egypt. Thank you, Andrew. Thank you, Paul.
Thank you.
God bless. Bye-bye.